Welcome at the masterclass, big name for a modest word, in supply chain dynamics as an example of what is it that I will be offered in the or that I will be asked to digest in the information management master. My name is Henk Akkermans. I'll do a bit of further introduction later on during my slides. I'll give you a pre-warning. It may not start off immediately as something which you expect to be getting in information management. So it may sound more like something in an MBA course, but we'll be getting there. I start off with ASML. ASML, one of the better known high-tech giants in the Netherlands, and this is way back in 2001 when I was still an assistant professor at Eindhoven University of Technology, where there are a close connection with ASML, had some students there. And what you see here is a performance graph, as we like in information management. What you see here for ASML, for those of you who missed that, ASML is a company that makes equipment by which you can make chips, by which you can make integrated circuits, ICs. And as such, they're all the way up in the whole business value chain from, the iPhone that I have, which contains chips, which were made on by companies like Intel and Samsung, etc. And they use machines, and those machines, some of them are made by ASML. Way back 2001. In 2000, the world was good for ASML. The blue lines are the machines they shipped. This is worldwide, by the way. This is not ASML specific data. I have those, but I can't share those with you. But this is a fair, this is public material. The green lines are the bookings. So you see, wonderful years. 2000 was a wonderful year. I know I was around at that time at ASML, and they were busy like hell. So in the start of summer in 99, and I have some quotes here from the Dow Jones, from the called the Wall Street Journal. Somewhere in 2000, what they call the book-to-bill ratio, which is the total number of new orders coming in divided by the total numbers of orders actually being shipped, dropped below one. And that in that case, that means that actually the amount of work that you have as a company, the order book is shrinking, which often suggests that the tide is turning. Because if you're in a cycle, you sell more tomorrow than you did today, then the order book will be growing. Now it's shrinking. It was partly, but it was a little blip. And the people at Philips Semiconductors that I also worked for at the time, they noticed. Their suppliers, ASML, did not notice. They really believed that these good times would last forever. Let me continue. In January, the mood was still very optimistic. And indeed, if you look at the official reports, the stuff that you can read in the news, ASML was better than anyone believed. Although some of the good times may have already been somewhat over. But we didn't know that. And then all of a sudden, one of the quotes here by Doug Dunn, the CEO of ASML, said at that time, well, there are some customers, 3 to 4, have asked us to delay shipments to the second half of the year, but still we're fine. That's January. In March, the stock market crashed. And shortly after that, on March 16, ASML had to lower its forecasts. And we're around in this period now. But still lower forecast, not good news for the stock market. Bang! Just in July, it predicts a loss, where this was a record top year, as the US revenue dropped sharply. So they weren't selling anymore to US customers. And in October 2016, they actually had to fire some 1,400 people. That sounds like a modest job. It's still 1,400 too many. But you have to recognize that ASML, of the total product, they make 5%, 2%. So if ASML fires 1,000 people, it means some 20,000 jobs are lost in the whole supply base, which mostly is also in the Netherlands and in this area. So this was a big lost for the region. If you still hear people talking about how wonderful the Eindhoven region has its acts together, then please remember that 10 years ago they were in deep shit. And you would say, you might argue, hey, how could that happen? In supply chain management, often we talk about 10% more, 10% less. Here we talk about from here to here, from say this period here of 150 up to here 500. So that's easily 300% more. And from the 300 back to here, 50, well, 80% less. So really big swings. Okay, that's ASML. Just one example. I'll give you two more. This is the Airbus A380, a wonderful new plane, the biggest plane, commercial plane that flies nowadays. Originally thought of in 2000. Again, a graph in the time. What you see here in the graph is the total, the cumulative number of orders for that very big plane. So thought of in 2000, launched as a program in the beginning of 2000, around 2004. Internally, there were signs of delays. Delays in the, because this making of a plane is not just a big plane, it's also a very big project. Technical problems because it's a horribly complex. Just to give one non-trivial example, the amount of cables. Does anyone have any idea how many meters of cable go into an A380 plane? 200 kilometers. But 20 kilometers sounds already crazy. 200 kilometers of cable in one plane. So that's a crazy amount. And that's just the easiest part, you would say, of designing a plane is the cabling. I mean, it also has to fly and the engines and the avionics, etc. So that was in 2004. In 2005, actually the first A380 was shown to the public. And the one flew, the first plane also flew from Paris to New York. I remember I taught a class beginning 2007 here to kids. We have a kids university initiative, and I said, and I gave this example, and some kid in the audience says, "No, sir, that's not true, because there's no because I've seen on the Yogyakarta that there was an A380 flying," and said, "That's true, but it was only one, because the problem is they couldn't make more." They could make one, hand-stitched as an expensive shoe, you could almost say, but they couldn't get the industrial process going. Basically, very simply put, at the very end of the manufacturing process, you have the one end of the plane and the other plant. This part is made in Germany and in Spain. This part is made in France. They have to be connected. You have to connect all the cables, those 200 kilometers, to remind you. And then you press run or on, and it doesn't work. And how do you then check all the cabling? Now, lots of other technical reasons for that, but to continue my story, in July 2005, the first delay was announced after this delay in making it public, in making lots of them. In 2006, yet another layer, it was official that they had a new delay. In June of that also, as a result of this, all of a sudden, the shares plummeted, a 0.25%. We talk EADS, that's a European giant, that's a very big conglomerate. The top officials could step down. There was a third delay in October, and customers started canceling freighters, 10 planes, each plane easily worth 150 million or so. So that's 1.5 billion, whoop, down the drain. And indeed, in March of that year, EADS had to fire 10,000 staff, again with a whole host of suppliers behind that. I was doing research at Fokker at that time. They supply most of the hull of the aerostructure with a very innovative material. They had their factory open, but it couldn't deliver for a whole year. That was an expensive year. So what happened here? We're not talking about, so we have an extremely well-educated company, tens of thousands of people, lots of higher degrees in it, many, I don't know how many had a degree from Tilburg University, but very well planned, etc. And they're 2.5 years late. And it actually leads to disastrous results, not just a month late, no, years late. And actually, they could have seen it years coming earlier on, and yet it was announced only 2 years later. What happened there? Last example. Oh, yeah, and a lousy 3.5 billion euros loss. This is Holland again. This is KPN. This is Internet plus Bellen. Internet plus Bellen was a wonderful, is still a wonderful product by KPN. It was also wonderful because the strategy of KPN was that it would cannibalize its own business. Back in 2005, the cable companies were making serious strides into cutting into the telephony business of KPN. KPN, your parents and your grandparents used KPN for the telephony. And of course, if you want to look at a TV, you use the cable company. But with the rise of voice over internet protocol, technology by which you could use telephony over the internet protocol, customers all of a sudden could watch TV via the television. Oh, sorry, could call via the television. So that VoIP services were now very common. KPN saw it happening, saw it losing customers because it was cheaper on the other side. They could do two things. They could wait, or they could launch their own product, and they did the last thing. There was voice over internet. It was Internet plus Bellen. It was a huge success. I was again working in that area up here. And when they originally introduced the service, they dimensioned it for 500 orders a week, and then the first day they had 10,000 orders. So again, bang! You know, not 5% more, but 500% more. And at this peak, they sold 70,000 orders in 1 week, which is a wonderful success. And they, I have the minutes of this meeting. They had champagne, etc. Oh, we also have some problems in delivery and complaining customers. Because all those 100,000 customers, they actually sold the product, they couldn't get the product delivered to in time. It was just too complex. So the storyline here, launch of the new product, very successful sales, record sales up here in the summer of 2007. But the pipeline, so you had new orders coming in, they couldn't get them installed for you quickly enough. More and more complaints. What actually happened was that in Radar, and how you call those customer programs, the KPN senior managers were asked to explain what was happening to a whole room filled with outraged, very angry customers. And they were grilled. They were tortured on live audience, more or less, because they simply couldn't explain what was happening. Yes, we're working on it. It's difficult, etc. So that happened around the end of 2007, and top management team decided to stop entirely promotion and sales. Bang! We don't sell it. Only those people who really come and ask for it, we still deliver. So the very again, going from 500 to almost 50,000 here and back again, hundreds of percentages. Not your usual supply chain management. Official estimates of KPN, something like 100 million of avoidable losses there. Okay. This is these three cases are all three cases that are separate chapters in my course on supply chain dynamics. I actually have 9 of those cases, which first are started with some theory chapters and then some reflection on it. And every time it's bang, that's the kind of the tsunami, I call it business tsunami aspect of supply chain. Very wild fluctuations. And in order to understand those, you need to understand about operations management, because these are really physical supply chains so far, although and service supply chain, but really operations about how do you actually do stuff. There's a lot of organization and management theory about it. These are networks. And also the toolkit, the theoretical lens through which you look at this, is system dynamics. And system dynamics is a methodology developed originally in the 1950s and 80s by Professor Jay Forrester of MIT, who comes from the area of control engineering. I have the very special pleasure of visiting him once more in May this year. The man is 96 years old. He apologized for the fact that he couldn't receive me in his office in MIT because he's there very rarely, and if I could visit him at home. So really old stuff, wonderful stuff, but it's a methodology that allows you to model these processes, these very highly non-linear, chaotic almost processes, and make simulation models out of those so that you can understand the world a bit better. Every case starts with an interview, a fireside chat, recorded next to a fire chat with me there, with one of the key executives. So the people who actually were running this business at the time, because I was around in most of those cases, I could ask them, could you come and give a guest lecture? But also, if you can't come for the guest lecture, can I ask you to give me an interview? And we have those, 9 of those interviews. Every time, there's also, of course, the classical text. I have 420 pages of text. But the most attractive thing for my students, I have 180 YouTube clips, which contain what my kids would call the gameplay walkthroughs. So all because I have, of all those cases, I have simulations, simulation models made in SysDynamics that replicate the behavior in the case, and you can conduct experiments with those simulation models and see what you could do better. But that's often cumbersome to understand. It's technical, and then you have to get up at be here at 8:45 in the morning on Friday morning and see me do stuff on the computer and what was it that he precisely did, etc. And oh, somebody has a status update on Facebook. No, you can do that in the leisure of your own home. You can check YouTube and see what happens there. And that's the content of this course. Now, you may ask, what's the connection to information management here? Lots. I also teach this course in the Master of Supply Chain Dynamics. So there they can ask, in the Master of Supply Chain Management with some modifications. So the link there is clear. But all of this is very much also in the information management domain. So first of all, we look at this from the perspective of the managers. The managers who made the decisions, and they make stupid decisions, fallible decisions. Is that because they're stupid? Is it because they're bad people? Is it because we, you and me, are better? No. There's actually an entire chapter about how fallible, how bad basically our dynamic decision making is. We as humans are simply not good in making decisions about those complex settings. We make mistakes. And part of the course is to see why those mistakes are made and what you can do. So it's information processes, it's human information processing. The topics, there's a case on an ERP implementation. There's a case on a sales and operations planning implementation. There's a case on a balanced scorecard implementation. There's a case on IT outsourcing, a case on supply chain transparency, a case on project planning. All these are standard curricular topics in the for an information management course, for an information management program, but they are cast in this real-world case of something that happened with the actual managers telling about it, and also with the simulation models describing what it actually meant if you make mistakes there. Thirdly, our analysis. This information management is in about computerized information systems or information systems in two ways. One, we study them as a problem. We study the problem of ERP implementation, the problem, but also our method, our analysis is often IT-based. We use IT tools, big data, decision support systems, simulation modeling, artificial intelligence, what have you, to understand, to make sense of the world. And this course is entirely driven on making simulation models of those business settings and analyzing those simulation models. Fourth, our learning style. I often ask, and I will ask this also in my course in this evening, who does not know how to use Bluetooth on its on his or her mobile phone? I assume that means everybody does. Okay. Of everybody, who has found out how Bluetooth worked by studying the manual? Yeah. No. Yeah. Oh, hey, Anne. Wow. Good. You're the one exception, but unfortunately, you're not part of the target audience. Anyway, so most of us find out how, well, I can ask, how did you learn how to use Bluetooth? Yes?
Just trial and error.
Trial and error, yeah, and it worked, yeah. Who used another method of finding out how Bluetooth works? Yes?
Instruction video somewhere on the internet.
Yeah, a YouTube video, how to use, okay. Yet another method? Yes, that's the third. Yeah, you ask somebody else. Anyway, so that works for you. The puzzling thing to me, since I've been teaching this stuff now for 15 years, 14 years to be exact, is that somehow those core human problem-solving skills that all of you possess are lost as soon as students step into an academic room. Because then, where is that in the book, professor? Could you tell me, explain a bit more? So, but this course is different. You have to figure out stuff yourself. So there are the models, there are the instructions videos, and now you figure it out. Figure out how stuff works. How do those models work? You can spend, as I did, 10 years on those models. You can spend 10 hours on those models and you will fail. 10 days and you will be successful. 10 weeks and you can become a PhD with me. So it depends on the matter. So you have to figure a lot out yourself. There are those 420 pages. Every single equation is explained in those. But you don't have to do that for my course, but you can. So it's very much the learning style of the engineer, of the information engineer, if you like, business school, in an economic school, which is unusual for many of my students. Yes, they can do that at home, but so it's not like the slides and last year's exam. No, you have to figure out stuff yourself. Can be confusing also because I give very modest hints on when you should finish something. Students can always come to me and ask questions and during the lectures. But basically, it's you. It's not me standing in front of the room with you sitting in the back, falling asleep. I went to class. Anyway, the learning how Bluetooth works approach. Fifth one, evaluation. The exam is a computer exam. You run models on the computer and do analysis from that. So it may sound all business-like, etc., and a case study, an MBA, whatever. But in the end, you have to do sensible stuff with a computer simulation model and make it. But it's about the real world, not some very theoretical program. And last but not least, what's information management about this course? It's me, your teacher. Why me? Well, that's me. I studied here information management, and I studied Japanese in a while, and I studied industrial engineering. I've been working at the interface and the business of, and I've been working for an IT consulting firm for a long time. Most of my work experience, most of my best references, academically speaking, are in the field of information management. But I've also been working a lot in the business area. In several of those areas, industries that you find cases of, that's me. So everything that I do has IT, has information management in it. The style how I work, so I use modeling a lot and modeling analysis, but also the topics. So although I'm not your average nerdy type, I certainly do have quite some of the more computer science or management science characteristics carefully hidden behind my suit. And sometimes it comes out. Okay. So far about the course in general. How am I doing on time? Yeah. Now, the very first reason, supply chain dynamics. Why is it that it's not 10% but 100 or 500% change? Well, that has to do with the world. The world has changed. Where are we coming from? Here's a personal story. In September 1987, just after graduating from this wonderful school, I planned to do my PhD research in business at Philips Electronics. Gradually, the story becomes less about me and more about Philips Electronics, because that's a good example. So, what can you tell? Well, first of all, the corporate staff at Philips Electronics actually did research, applied research. Not quite that common nowadays. And in fact, they had made serious contribution to the literature and the theory on supply chain management. I lived in a home which was rented to me by Philips. They had their own homes. Of course, every serious, Unilever, Shell, DSM, they all have sold homes, of course. My whole street did that. In the room, in my house, I have all this electronic equipment that I bought from the Philips personeelswinkel. And they made everything. They made refrigerators, they made CD players, you mentioned it. Everything that had electronic current through it, they made. It was, of course, made, and I had a serious tour of all those factories, in Philips factories. And the components were also made by Philips. and then sold under the Philips brand name. And of course, my sports activities were at the PSV nearby. Not the professional football team, but just the volleyball, etc. I did. This was the year, by the way, that PSV became a European champion, so I could benefit from that. I was just too young to build a pension at the Philips pension funds, which in retrospect is only too well, because I would be a few hundred million short. Well, is there, of course. And of course, my insurances were at IAK, the Philips Own Insurance Fund. That is reality one generation ago. Not quite 25 years, but a quarter of a century ago, just one generation. It's unheard of nowadays, just 25 years. So, what happened? Well, while I was there, the whole department was already reorganized. The whole big corporate staff was split up. The whole business, where there were all the non-core functions from cafeteria to IT were outsourced. All the component production went out. The assembly was outsourced to other companies. Engineering and even customer care were also outsourced. Middle management, the leemlaag, the brick layer, the clay layer was cut out. Performance evaluation was much more formal, much more geared towards the short term. Silly stuff like sponsoring PhD research in your company was certainly not thought of well. Most measurable financial company. The combination of different, back then you had Philips lighting and professional components and industrial equipment and medical, etc. That was then a bonus because, well, every year some company was doing well. But that was no longer thought of highly by the financial analyst, because that means that one company is in different sectors and they have these secret formulas by which they evaluate the volatility in, so the risk in a certain sector. And if you're in different sectors, they can't make their calculations anymore, so they don't like you. So that was split up, as Stork was split up, as many companies were split up. And management became, back then, almost all senior managers at Philips were Philips bred. They had worked in various areas around the world. Vast majority of them had a technical background. The other ones were in sales. And it's also thought of, we have an MBA manager. So Cor Boonstra, who was used to selling stuff in consumer goods and so, the Friesland milk, etc. He was brought in to save the company. And that's totally different. On a theoretical frame, when I was still studying here, this is how we looked, this is how my textbooks looked at the business, at companies. You had an internal value chain. Here you have, you think of new products and a number of steps. As a business, you make those products and you satisfy a certain market demand for a new product with a certain life cycle. And if you could only have, and we made calculation, optimizations calculation about that, for centralized decision making. One of the central mantra beliefs that we had here was, and I actually remember making those calculations, that it's if each of these parts try to optimize their own operations, it would be the sub-optimization of the whole. It was a saying like, een zwaluw nog geen zomer, or whatever. Optimization of the parts, a sub-optimization of the whole. But that's precisely what happened, isn't it? So in the reality, by the way, there wasn't the IT yet to manage all these factories in all those different countries as a whole. So in fact, it was managed bit by bit, because the IT and the governance could only manage doing it one step at a time. But what happened is that those life cycles shrank very much. And as a result of that, this is much more the reality. It's no longer a big supertanker, it's a convoy. And these are no longer supertankers, they are workboats, very small boats, and they have all their coordination. But how do these companies coordinate? That's very difficult. There is no, it's not the market anymore, and there is also not somebody centrally in charge. So how do you do that? Well, this is one of the reasons why companies have much greater difficulties. And the other reason, of course, that indeed the market has changed. So what you would like to have, or was struggling for, and which is also partly a task of information management, without anyone being in control, how can you still effectively coordinate your operations? And they were still searching. For me, when I saw this some 10, 15 years ago, there was a reason to come back to university, because the textbooks that I had as a student no longer were correct. this, how do we solve this? Well, and there are experiments. This is ASML, for instance. ASML, after this horrible period, they had a sales and operations process in which people from marketing and people from sales and people from operations and people from finance jointly agree on, okay, at the very least, this is what we know that we have in orders. This is the time. This is the cumulative orders that they have. If sales is really happy and lucky, then the red line is what we now think we can sell. So somewhere around there, we all agree and this is what we will make. Even though, and we share this with our suppliers and also with our customers, by the way. So you try to find some alignment through coordination of information. For the Airbus case, what would have helped them is collaborative planning. It's a tool, it's a way in which you actually, in the, this is case 10, chapter 10, collaborative planning. Here it was, these were some companies in the digital storage area. Here was supplier component suppliers. They all fed their information on what they thought, what they were planning to do this week and what they had in stock. And together, for the whole supply chain consisting of four or five different independent companies, it was calculated what was the best thing to do for the entire company. It's another example of how you could do that. And KPN, after the crash of the... by the way, and that's what Airbus should have done and is now doing today. In KPN, revived, actually, was a sales and operation planning. I say revived because one of the people that I work with there said, hey, we stopped this process 10 years ago and now we're starting it again. So again, all these different groups that together decide whether or not you can meet all the demand that you're getting in your service supply chain can be fulfilled and how you can do that. So that's a couple of the examples there. In all these examples, there are hard, tangible calculations to make about absolute numbers of orders and products and capacities. But the real difficult part is the human part, is the emotional part, is the feelings part. There is a technical background for this again, which is that all the feedback loops between how much you trust the other party and how much they trust you, or how much you trust somebody and how often you communicate with them, they are reinforcing and therefore destabilizing. So take this week in the press. What could easily happen is something happens in the Krim, in Ukraine, a very tiny element, and the Krim has been a problematic region for 300 years. The Russians do something which the Europeans don't like. The Europeans or the Americans react in a way which upsets the Russians. The Russians think we can do a bit more, and they send some more troops, which the Europeans reply with more sanction and more tough talk on the TV, etc., by which the Russians think, you know what, let's do this immediately. And before you know it, you have an escalation. So human emotions are often escalating, upward and downward. So if you have that in your personal relation, you can have a big fight, but after you can make up, and the more that you are nice to your dear one, the more that he or she will be nice to you, and the more cozy it will get. And that's a typical destabilizing mechanism which is needed to get all those all that technical stuff going. All the stuff about aligning of a capacity with demand, etc. So this is also an important part, and I also have three cases of focusing mostly on the relationship dynamics. That's also information management, but because the soft part is really the hard part. But we still study it with from a decision-making perspective. We still study it by making simulation models of stuff like trust, openness, communication, transparency, etc. So that's the challenge. Are you ready for takeoff? This was a very short intro into my course. I cannot tell you if it's really typical for information management. As a true academic, I am very focused on my own part of the curriculum, but you hear more about the other parts. But at least I've been asked to tell you a bit more about my course and what is it about. I think it's a nice combination of the business side of the so the management side of what somebody with a master in information management should be able to do and understand, and the IT side of what somebody with a master in information management should be able to do and understand, and also the teaching style with its blended learning of YouTube clips and simulation models and still text, etc. Is also, I think, representative for the kind of teaching style that we want. But the rest is up to you.